Is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome to Hope for the Journey, the Sunday morning broadcast here at the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church in Henrico, Virginia. And let me say, first of all, happy Mother's Day to all mothers. Happy Mother's Day. God bless you, and may this be a joyous day for you. We want to welcome you into our Sunday morning service. Let me share with you what the mission statement is of the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church. The mission and aim of the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church is in accordance with the Holy Scriptures, undergirded by the Articles of Faith. We are established for the purposes of Christian education and spiritual development, spreading the word of God through evangelism and public ministry, empowering the fellowship through worship. God bless you. That's the mission statement here at the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church. Hope you've had a wonderful week leading up to this fantastic Mother's Day. I want to give a quick shout out to two of our mothers who recently had birthdays on the same day, on April 27th, to our own Dina Smith and to Edith Johnson. Edith Johnson turned 92 years old. We won't say how young Dina Smith is, but God bless both of you who recently had birthdays here on the same day, April 27th, and hope you have a wonderful, wonderful day. I want to remind you that on next Saturday and Sunday, we will have our Women's Day festivities beginning on Saturday at noon here in the parking lot of the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church. Lots going to be going on, activities, games, fun. Women, men, all of us going to be out there enjoying the celebration of our Women's Day. So come on out and be a part of the festivities on Saturday beginning at 12 noon, and then Sunday morning worship with us in the parking lot of the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church. Our guest speaker will be Reverend Rachel Satterfield, who is associate minister at the Sixth Baptist Church here in Richmond, Virginia. I want to thank all of the members for your wonderful gifts and kind words on last week as I celebrated 22 years of pastoring people here at the Pilgrim Journey Baptist Church. Thank you for everything. You made my day. The drive-through was just fantastic. Some folk I hadn't seen in a whole year. So it's good to, it was good to see you and to share with you on 22 years of a celebration on last week. I called your attention this morning to verses of scripture in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 through 6. Revelations 12, verses 1 through 6. It reads thusly: "And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth and pained to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. And she brought forth a man-child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared by God, that they should feed her there for 1,260 days. Thus ends the reading of the word." And with that, today I want to speak on the subject, motherhood and monsters. Motherhood and monsters. Shall we pray? Almighty and everlasting God, thank you, thank you, thank you for another day. Another day of life, another day of that portion of our health and our strength, and being clothed and in our right minds enough to be able to worship you today, to give your name glory, honor, and praise. Oh, we thank you. Thank you for this Mother's Day that we celebrate, the mothers of our church and the mothers of our community and society and nation and world. Thank you for mothers. All of us have been mothered by somebody. Now, Lord, I ask your blessings upon this message, that it will make plain its meaning, that it will help celebrate the power of mothers and motherhood, and how powerful it is to give birth, what that means, and how you have sanctified and ordained birth in the face of extraordinary atrocities and extraordinary circumstances. We still come forth. Now bless the word, O Lord, today, and bless the people who hear it, that they may be blessed even more. We ask, O Lord, that you take these few words and make them thine. Help us to see clearer the meaning of this strange text, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, help them and let them be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer, our strength and our redeemer, in the name of Jesus it is that I pray. Amen and amen. Motherhood and monsters. This passage of scripture reads like a scene out of the script of a science fiction movie, or from the pages of a Grimm's fairy tale, or an episode out of some Greek mythology or medieval lore. A woman languishing and anguishly suffering through the final moments of labor. A woman at the very point of when the sorrows of delivering will be replaced by the joy of delivery. She is all about to move from maternity to motherhood. But while she is enduring this, there is a monster waiting. A monster who has sniffed out the birthing process and has arrived to consume it. The monster is in the very delivery room, anticipating the consumption of this newborn child. Thus, the nearly newborn child will go from mother to monster. Motherhood and monsters. What a strange interaction. How opposite can these two be? Motherhood representing the highest form of humanity, and giving birth is the highest act in nature, as opposed to monsterhood, which is humanity at its lowest form. Yet, these two, mother and monster, stand face to face, waiting for what is to come forth. In the verses of scripture out of the 12th chapter of John, John says, a great wonder appeared in heaven. A woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. She was pregnant and in labor, travailing in the process of giving birth. And then he says another wonder in the sky, a huge red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns. On each head was an ornament. His tail swept down a third of the stars in the sky and threw them down upon the earth. In chapter 13 of the book of Revelation, the dragon is described as having spots like a leopard, and feet like a bear, and a mouth like a lion, and made blasphemous utterings. In verses 7 through 9 in chapter 12, it says that the dragon was at war with the archangel Michael and was defeated and cast down. That ancient serpent called the devil and Satan. The deceiver of the whole world was thrown down to earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Now, this monster stands before this mother while she is in labor. Now, two things strike me as interesting in this scenario of Scripture. First, how the mother is dressed. The description of her outfit was interesting to me. She is dressed in the sun and has the moon for shoes and 12 stars for a hat. And perhaps the 12 stars is some allusion to the 12 tribes of Israel. But nevertheless, the mother is clothed in light. She has on what we might call light wear. The mother is clothed in light from head to toe, wrapped in the sun, shoes of the moon, hat of the stars. She is covered from head to toe in light. Now we know that light represents illumination. Light represents spirituality. Light represents sanctification. Light represents purity and power. She is covered in light. And this light now stands before darkness. Notice that the text said about the dragon that his tail threw down a third part of the stars in the sky. Evidently, this monster doesn't like light. Monsters don't come out in the light. The monster has a lot of heads and a lot of crowns, but no light. It is some thought that this dragon represents the authority of nations. But no matter the presumed authority, it is not operative in the light. The monster has a whole lot of heads and a whole lot of tail, but no light. But this woman who is about to give birth is clothed in light from head to toe, and I will come back to that in a moment. Nevertheless, the second thing that I noticed was that although the monster was monstrous and a monstrosity, his power was limited. His presence before this delivering woman does not stop her labor. She sees the monster, but labor does not decrease. She sees the intent of the dragon, but she keeps on pushing. And at the point of our text, labor is stronger than the presence of the prevailing monster. The dragon stands before the woman in delivery, but it does not have any power over what's happening. He can't speed up the delivery. He can't slow down the delivery. No power over the labor pains. No power over the pregnancy. No power over delivery. No power over the birthing process. The monster does not have the power to cause a miscarriage. The monster is present, but the woman keeps on pushing. So the power of birth is greater than the presence of monsters. Motherhood is stronger than monsterhood. Now, this sci-fi scene gave me an even greater appreciation of motherhood at the giving birth stage. It showed me how powerful life is. God has endowed mothers to bring forth even in the face of monsters. And children are born every day into a world where monsters await them. Monsters of poverty, but it can't stop life. Monsters of disease, can't stop birth. Monsters of war, monsters of viral epidemics, monsters of starvation, can't stop the birthing process. Mothers all over nature produce daily, give birth daily in the face of dragons in whatever form they come, because there is a greater power in giving birth than in the monsters who wish to take it away. John says, I saw a great wonder in the heavens, a woman clothed with the sun and having the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she cried in her pregnancy, travailing in the birth process, hoping to deliver soon. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. And behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head, and his tail threw down a third part of the sun, the stars in the sky, on the earth he cast them. And the dragon stood before the woman, and the monster stood in front of the woman, who was ready to give birth, in order to consume, in order to devour the child as soon as it came forth. But you know what? The text says in verse 9, but she brought forth. The monster is standing there growling. The monster is standing there, foaming at the mouth, dripping blood through his teeth, waiting to consume the child. This does not deter the mother from bringing forth the child. Text says, and she brought forth in the very face of that which threatened the existence of what she was bringing forth. She brought forth in the very presence of that which was perilous to what she was bringing forth. She brought forth in the very midst of the devil who sought to consume the child, in the very throes of evil, who is in her audience, she still brings forth. There is no attempt to withdraw on the part of this mother. There's no attempt to pull back on the part of this mother. Motherhood is stronger than monsters that await. The text says, and she brought forth a man child who was to rule over all nations with an iron rod. She brought forth a child that had a bright future. She brought forth a child that was going to turn out to be somebody. But there is a monster in the delivery room waiting to sniff out any becoming that this child might achieve. But not only in the delivery room was monsters that awaited her, that awaited this child. The monsters that await our children are in the world as we bring forth as well. Monsters await in the world Monsters are waiting in the nation. Monsters await in the state. Monsters await in the city. Monsters await in the community. Monsters await in the neighborhood. Monsters await in the family. Monsters are waiting to eat up our children in the midst of birth. As soon as they come forth, there are monsters waiting. But the monsters cannot stop the processes of birth. The processes of motherhood are too strong for whatever or whoever the monster that might be waiting. And so the monster is in the room as the woman brings forth this son. He's there to consume the child, but it was not to be so. Because as soon as the child was born, the Bible says he was caught up unto God and to God's throne. Now, in light of this seemingly science fiction drama, what was inevitably supposed to happen in that birthing room did not happen. A man child born to a mother who delivered in the face of a monster who was waiting to devour the child, that did not happen, for the child was caught up to the throne of God. He was caught up into absolute safety. Now, what are the reasons for this unusual deference? As close as the monster was to the mother and the child, why didn't what the monster wanted happen? Well, it all had to do with the mother. It all had to do with the mother. The child's benefits came from his mother. First of all, the mother was in relationship with God before motherhood. Mothers and mothers of the future, you ought to have a relationship with God. One not pre-predicated on family. One not pre-predicated on marriage or children. You ought to have a relationship with God before you extend your family. Before you marry somebody or have any children, you ought to try God. Get to know God, because when you are acquainted with God, there is favor, I tell you, that you're going to need in order to face the monsters of this world. Be in relationship with God. Now, because the mother had a relationship with God, she had refuge with God. A mother gives birth before a monster, but when the child is born, he is immediately caught up before the throne of God. Then verse 6 says, and the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared by God that they should feed her, take care of her, 1,260 days, roughly 3.5 years. God provided a refuge for the mother from the monster. And it gets real sci-fi over in verse 13 of chapter 12 through verse 17, where it says, and I paraphrase, now when the dragon saw it, that it was cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman who brought forth the man child. But she was given the wings of an eagle, that she could fly into the wilderness to her place, where she would be nourished and protected from the serpent. But the dragon cast from his mouth a flood of water after the woman to sweep her away. But the earth opened its mouth and swallowed the flood. And the monster was angry with the woman and went to war with the rest of her children who kept the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. But because she is in relationship with God, she has refuge in God. God is my refuge and my strength, a very present help in times of trouble. This mother gives birth in the presence of a monster, but she has a relationship and refuge with God. And so the child then is born, and the monster awaits to kill him, but he is immediately caught up unto God's throne. The devil didn't get him. Oh, people are born in the most extraordinary, heinous, atrocious circumstances of life, but they still turn out because God has power over monsters. And if you're in relationship with God, you can still give birth to something that will outdo and overdo all of the adversities that come against that birth. The devil won't get your child because the mother had a relationship with God and refuge with God. She made reservations for the child with God before the child was born. Thus, the child was born belonging to God and not to the world. His mother had already promised him to God as soon as he was born. And though he comes into a world with monsters waiting, he finds sanctuary at the throne of God. His mother made reservations for him, I tell you. He is promised to God before he gets here. He is dedicated to God before he's delivered. Thus, the monster that is present at his birth cannot consume him. His mother makes reservations for him. Now, one may wonder still how this child escapes the monster that stands on the front side of birth waiting to devour him. How does the monster so close miss his chance, miss his opportunity? This great red dragon who stood there with 7 heads and 10 horns, his tail had knocked down that part of the stars that were in the sky, stood there in front of this woman ready to consume the child, so close, but he still missed his chance. The only answer has to be that there was another presence in the birthing room that the monster couldn't see or see past. Someone or something closer to the birthing process than the dragon was. Let's review the text to see what it might have been. John said, a great wonder in heaven. I saw a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and a crown of thorns, a crown of 12 stars that is upon her head, and she, being in labor, cried and pained to be delivered. And there also was a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns, whose tail had brought down a third part of the stars upon the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, stood right in front of her labor, in order to devour the child as soon as it was born. But she brought forth a man-child who would rule all nations with an iron rod. And her child was caught up instantly unto God. The New Oxford Annotated Bible says he was snatched away and taken to God, to his throne. Well, who snatched him? No one else was there but the mother and the monster. Yet there was another presence there in the very delivery room. There was another presence, I tell you, closer than the monster. A presence that the monster could not see through. Though as plain as day, it was invisible to the monster. There was another presence there, I tell you, and it was in the mother's day outfit. It was in the mother's day outfit, I tell you, that the woman was wearing. She was clothed in the sun and the moon under her feet, and she had a crown of 12 stars on her head. The sun is her dress, the moon are her shoes, and the crown of stars is her hat. In other words, the woman is clothed, I said it earlier, from head to foot in light. She goes into labor in front of a monster, but he has no power because there is another presence. The woman is dressed in it. She is dressed in the light. It's closer to her than the monsters of the world. It's closer to her than any evil that might come to her child. It's closer to her than anything that might seek to harm the child. The woman is dressed in light. Well, let me take it out of sci-fi for you and put it in regular language. If you had to interview the woman, that interview might go like this: lady, didn't you see that monster standing there right in front of you in the delivery room when you were about to give birth, waiting to devour your newborn? She would say, yes, I saw him. Weren't you afraid? No, I wasn't afraid. Why weren't you afraid? Well, I heard the psalmist say, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies, came upon me to eat up my flesh, or the flesh of my child, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. The Lord is my light. The Lord is my light. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The monster couldn't see because he was looking out of darkness, but the light blocked him. And so when the child was born, he was snatched up into the glory of God, into the throne of God, into the presence of God. God has ordained birth. God has ordained birth to be able to come forth even in the face of monsters. God has ordained mothers to give birth even in the face of monsters. Mothers, thank you. Thank you for your faith. Though you gave birth in troubling times, though you gave birth in times of lack, though you gave birth in times when relationships wasn't were what they should be, though you gave birth in time when there were calamities in the world, when there was war going on in the world, when monsters were all around, you still gave birth, and we turned out to be somebody. We turned out all right because you gave us to the Lord before you offered us to the world. Mothers, have a great day today. Enjoy the day. May your families treat you with special, special, special love and care on this Mother's Day, because it had not been for you, all your faith in God, we would not be. God bless you. We'll see you on next Sunday, Women's Day. God bless you. Take care.
What?
See, you was gonna lose the game, well, baby.
Man, was we crazy?
Yeah, man. Tell me about the other fellas, little Sonny.
You drinking that wine? Remember the schoolyard days?
Yeah. We had to take you home, man. You were out of it,
oh,
man.
Oh, better, better day. Lord have mercy.
Hey, but listen.
Yeah.
Remember when we used to run around there? Steal the hubcaps off the car.
What you talking about? In batteries?
We lucky we ain't get busted, man.
Listen.
Then I say, here comes the fun.
Oh. Hey, Bird, what corner was you coming to me?
That tenderloin.
Oh, man.
Oh, man.
But dig this here.
Yeah.
Now, see, when all that gang war was going on, I'll tell you one thing I never forget.
And what's that?
See, when I got home, first thing I would hear is,
what?
Bill!
Yeah.
Where you been, boy?
That's it.
I say, I was out with Sonny Bird and Lil Sonny.
Put it all on us.
Yeah.
I had to put it on somebody.
Hey, Bill, what your mama say?
She say, boy, now I'm going to tell you.
What?
You know you getting big now.
Yeah.
You got to watch the things that you doing out in that street.
Right.
And you go to jail.
Right.
And I'm going to tell you something, man. Mama wasn't wrong.
No.
But what about Pop? Oh, we ain't talking about Pop.
No, man. Pop,
boy,
he was all right.
Pop
was hanging out, you know.
Yeah, hanging out.
I think Pop was drinking more wine than we used to. I know my pop did.
Yeah.
My pop hung right on with you, boy.
Yeah.
Stay out all night. Come on, clothes all wrinkled up. Lip balls all on them.
Hey, Sonny. How about when your mom cooked them good home-cooked bits of baby?
Mr. Green?
Oh, man.
Boy, your